which the breeze o'er the towering steep, as it fitfully blows, half conceals, half discloses. Now it catches the gleam of the morning's first beam. Now in full glory reflected, now shines in the stream. 'Tis the Star Spangled Banner, oh, long may it wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. And where is that band who so boldly swore that the havoc of war and the battle's confusion a home and a country should leave us no more? Their blood has washed out their foul footsteps' pollution. No
want to thank all the elements of the procession that so reverently escorted the Star Spangled Banner manuscript from the temporary exhibit at Frederick City Hall, where it has been since yesterday afternoon, here to Francis Scott Key's grave at Mount Olivet Cemetery, as we termed it, Anthem and Author Reunited. We had, of course, the Frederick Police Department leading the way. They have been fantastic to work with in the planning and execution of this visit, and certainly keeping the document safe while it was here with us in Frederick. The United States Army Old Guard, in many capacities, have been terrific in the planning and certainly just added so much to our event today. The Maryland National Capitol, Park Police, Montgomery County for the horse-mounted units that were part of the escort. The Independent Hose Company, if you saw that antique hose reel come in, pulled among others by a couple of our county commissioners. The Independent Hose Company is Maryland's oldest continuously operating volunteer fire company. It was actually formed the same decade that the Star Spangled Banner was written. And the Maryland Capitol Police, who have been transporting the document from its home in Baltimore here to Frederick and between the stops in Frederick. So let's thank all of the participants in our program this morning. This time I'd like to thank the elected officials that have joined us today, or at least those that I have seen so far. From the state of Maryland, the delegation from Frederick County to Annapolis, Delegate Galen Claggett and Delegate Kelly Schultz. Thank you for joining us. From the Board of Frederick County Commissioners, President Blaine Young, Paul Smith, Billy Shreve, Kirby DeLauder, and David Gray. Thank you all for joining us. I also want to mention that we have a former Frederick County Commissioner with us. I see Sterling Bollinger, who is also a member of a Francis Scott Key Memorial Foundation Board. Sterling, thank you for joining us. And from the City of Frederick, Mayor Randy McClement, and I've seen Alderman Kelly Russell and Carol Krim so far, and Shelley Alloy, thank you for joining us today. Any other aldermen that I missed? So thank you very much. And we truly appreciate the city staff, not only the police department, but your city hall staff, and the elected officials have just been terrific to work with on this special occasion. We certainly want to thank General Caravallo for joining us from Fort Detrick, and also Colonel Stephen Middlecamp, the new garrison commander that is at Fort Detrick. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us. As you saw, the final movement of the cased flag was here to the monument of Francis Scott Key. The backside of the monument actually features all four stanzas. They were set in bronze by a sculptor who didn't even speak English. He had the story of the monument translated to him from an Irishman who did enough business on the continent that he was able to explain it in Italian, and set all four stanzas. And I can tell you from our tourism perspective that we see so often that this is the first time that many people realize there's more than one stanza. So if you haven't had a chance, take a look at the backside of the monument. At this time, I would like to invite to make welcoming remarks from the City of Frederick, Mayor Randy McClement.
First, I want to take a little side note to personally thank a friend of mine, Mr. Vince Hall, who is 99 years old, and as John mentioned, next year will turn 100. He served our country in the Army. He did right after D-Day. He just told me he came home on the USS Enterprise, came home on Christmas Eve, and docked in New York City. We asked, was there a big reception? He said, nope, we just got off the boat. But thank you very much, Vince, for being here. This is a glorious day to be in the city of Frederick. On behalf of the citizens of Frederick, the Board of Aldermen, and myself, I want to thank you for joining us in this historic event. The reuniting of the original manuscript of the Star Spangled Banner and its author, and Frederick County's native son, Francis Scott Key. It's fitting that the song lyrics inspired by the American flag have been displayed at the very site of the courthouse where Francis Scott Key began his law career. The building that is today's City Hall was Frederick County's third courthouse. During the Civil War, it replaced the 1785 courthouse building in which Key practiced. Key was born on a plantation named Terra Rubra, then a part of Frederick County, on August 1st, 1779. He would die in 1843 in the city of Baltimore. But in 1866, in keeping with his wishes, His body would be moved from Baltimore here to Mount Olivet Cemetery in the city of Frederick. The Key Monument Association erected a memorial in 1898, and the remains of both Francis Scott Key and his wife, Mary Taylor Lloyd Key, were placed in a crypt in the base of this monument. As I noted earlier, today we witness for the first time the reuniting of this great Fredericktonian with an immortal script penned after seeing the 15-star American flag still waving at dawn's early light following the bombardment of Fort McHenry by the British during the Battle of Baltimore. The city of Frederick is honored to have played host to this once-in-a-lifetime event. We want to express our sincere gratitude to the Maryland Historical Society for allowing us this opportunity. I hope you all had the opportunity to see the script. It was amazing. It was a once-in-a-lifetime event. And the one thing, a couple things that I take away from it, one that I thought was kind of neat, is the fact when you look at the script, you realize the gentleman who wrote it was human. There are scratch outs in there. You didn't quite, nah, this isn't right, let's try that again. This doesn't rhyme, but no. But it was very, very humble and inspiring to see. And I want to thank all of you for coming out. This is a fantastic turnout for a wonderful event. I want to thank everybody who participated in this. We here in Frederick are very proud to be able to honor our native son, Francis Scott Key, in this way. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Mayor. And as Mayor McClement indicated, that is one of the comments that we have heard over and over from people that did have the chance to see the document while it was downtown. And as of a couple of hours ago, the last time I was at City Hall, it had been more than 2,000 folks that had been through there. So we're delighted to have had this opportunity. And we have heard that same observation. Yes, you could tell he was human. He rethought a couple of the words, changed the lyrics. And in addition to that, I think he so brilliantly captured the sentiment. When you think about it, at his time, Frederick County butted up against Baltimore County. Basically, it was the world's most powerful Navy sailing into the next county, and he was viewing that. Having the military so prominently represented today is very appropriate, as he captured, as we heard Tracy sing in that fourth stanza, "Oh, thus be it ever when free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation," giving you that sense of that line of protection. And in a banquet that happened at the very site of our temporary exhibit on Courthouse Square, 20 years after the Star Spangled Banner was written, and Francis Scott Key was being saluted at this banquet by local residents for his patriotism, it was he who said that the glory truly belonged to the defenders, men such as those that had camped right across the street here on the grounds of the historic Fredericktown Barracks and marched from here directly to Baltimore and were among those defenders. I can tell you as a little side note that the sculptor who I referenced earlier, Pompeo Capini, who had come over here hoping to find a lot of work on the continent. He had apprenticed in Florence, where there were sculptors everywhere. He thought he would get a lot of work in America, sailed over here, was down on his luck, and almost ready to end it all, according to Judge Delaplane, the gentleman for whom we're pardoned over here, who's named historian that tracked down Mr. Capini in the 1950s and got the story about the sculpting of this monument. His luck turned around after this job, and in fact, he married the model for Columbia, Elizabeth Barbieri. They moved to San Antonio and lived happily ever after. If you see any monuments in Texas, he probably did them. The cenotaph at the Alamo, the large Neptune fountain at the University of Texas, all the monuments on the Capitol grounds. And so that's a happy story that got its start right here as well. At this time, I am pleased to call forward William Pensick, who is the Executive Director of the Maryland War of 1812 Commission. Rush here from Annapolis, where they have just concluded a very prominent and successful International War of 1812 conference. Thank you, Bill, for joining us.
Thank you, John, very, very much. It's really such an honor and privilege to be joining you here today. This picture, postcard, perfect day in beautiful Frederick. I am the director of the Maryland War of 1812 Bicentennial Commission. I would like to thank the Tourism Council, the principal sponsors for this event. There are many, many participants today, who John has recognized, but it's the Tourism Council of Frederick County in partnership with the Maryland Historical Society Francis Scott Key Memorial Foundation and the City of Frederick, who are the principal sponsors here. So I think we really need to give them a hand. You know, Frederick is at the intersection point of so many significant national heritage stories, and at the Frederick Visitor Center is one place you can begin to get an introduction to those stories before you go out and experience the real places. Because I'm director of the 1812 Commission, I'm sort of paid to believe that the story of the War of 1812 and the Chesapeake, resulting in these two great national icons, the flag and our national anthem, is perhaps Maryland's most significant national heritage story and contribution to the nation. You know, the anthem, the words to the anthem themselves are universal to Americans. The flag, which flew over the fort, made in Maryland, now in the National Museum of American History, is the most sought-out object in the entire collection of the National Museum of American History. 4 million people from around the world go to see that object every year. So these stories clearly resonate with us, and Frederick is central to all of that. The commission, to put Frederick and the events and the contributions of Frederick in the context of the work that the Maryland Commission is doing a little bit, the commission was created under executive order by Governor O'Malley a few years ago, as recognizing that this bicentennial is a one-time chance to elevate Maryland globally as this incredible place to live, work, and visit that we know that it is, that we can take great pride in this significant national heritage story, but we can also make some economic hay out of it. And this, the commission is embedded within the state's Department of Business and Economic Development and its Division of Tourism, Film, and the Arts. You know, despite the name War of 1812, it was a 32-month war. It began in June of 1812, didn't end until February of 2015. So our 32-month bicentennial commemoration, which we brand Star Spangled 200, you know, thus the license plate, go visit starspangled200.com or .org to find out more. Our bicentennial commemoration began back in June 2012 with Star Spangled celebration in the Inner Harbor in the Upper Chesapeake. That event, where 45 vessels from a dozen nations from around the world brought 1.5 million people, more than a third of whom were from outside of Maryland, to come spend more than $166 million here and create the equivalent of 4,000 full-time jobs just for that one week-long event. The bicentennial commemoration continues, with events like this all over the state. Over the next 18 months, more than a dozen mini celebrations and celebrations like this are taking place, because the story of the War of 1812 in the Chesapeake was truly a statewide story. Communities from the head of the bay to lower southern Maryland to the eastern shore to the capital region, the entire state was impacted very, very significantly by this conflict. As John alluded, we've just completed two back-to-back conferences, bringing about 500 conferees from the United Kingdom, Canada, and all over the United States. The first of them, Cross-Tech Cyber Defense in the 21st Century, brought together the thought leaders, the policy setters, in cyber defense, the new frontier of keeping the world safe and free. From Enemies to Allies, an international conference on the War of 1812 and its aftermath, again, was just a wonderful exploration of 1,000 days of war, 200 years of peace, what that has meant to our three great nations. And then lastly, the 32-month bicentennial commemoration will end in September, well, not end, but the big signature event before the February 2015 end is in September 2014, when the events which led directly to the writing of the Star Spangled Banner took place. Star Spangled Spectacular will take place, so stay tuned. So where does Frederick fit? Obviously, Francis Scott Key is important. It's just such an obviously central figure to Maryland in this national story. He wasn't just human. He didn't just make mistakes. He was a young human when he wrote this, our national anthem. He was in his 30s. He was the father of four. He was an opponent of the war. You know, we all have feelings of ambiguity about war, particularly when we declare them. The War of 1812 was more controversial than Vietnam among the American public, and Francis Scott Key was one of those. He came, however, to see the British as cruel oppressors. He knew of their plans to plunder Baltimore after the burning of Washington. He was on the British ships. He knew too much. And while he was kept on the ships in the harbor, after having successfully negotiated the release of the gentleman who's going to be coming on stage after me, the pre-battle anxiety must have been intense. So the words, please do take time. If you're not familiar with the four stanzas, take the time to read them. We heard them by Miss Lord. They are very meaningful. It was not only Key, however, of the human beings that contributed to the war effort. And this isn't to diminish Francis Scott Key, but it's really meant to help inform the words to the anthem. Thanks to Frederick and the Tourism Council's Chris Hall, he really was the first one several years ago that clued me into the four captives by Americans captured by the British, sort of in the Boston Massacre event of the War of 1812. Four men were impressed, taken captive, seized off the USS Chesapeake by the Royal Navy. Two of them were African American, two of them were from Maryland. One of them, William Ware, was from Pipe Creek, what was then Frederick County. He was taken off, they were all taken off to Halifax, tried. William Ware was imprisoned in Dartmoor Prison in southern England, where he died. This, in 1807, was an outrage to the American public. It was the Boston Massacre of the War of 1812, and these events of impressment led directly to the U.S. declaration of the war in 1812. As John said, Frederick County contributed hundreds and hundreds of fighters, militia, to the war in the Chesapeake. And as he said, next to Green Mount in Baltimore, Mount Olivet contains more burials of 1812 veterans than any other cemetery. Lastly, I just want to emphasize that clearly, he, you know, if the first verse, the first stanza of the national anthem is a question, he's asking the question, is the flag still there? It ends in a question mark. In the second verse, I like to call it the Chesapeake verse. It speaks of seeing the flag reflected in the stream. It places this national history in our backyard, in the Chesapeake. The last verse is clearly, in my mind, a tribute to Marylanders, the original land of the free and the home of the brave. Study the words carefully. So I think, and the next time you have the opportunity to sing the national anthem, sing it a little louder, sing it a little stronger, knowing that he wrote it about Maryland and Marylanders. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Bill. We really appreciate you joining us today. We know that it has been quite the whirlwind week coordinating those two international conferences to have you join us here in Frederick. And as was mentioned about the number of War of 1812 veterans here at Mount Olivet Cemetery, we hope that 15 months from now, when the Star Spangled Banner actually turns 200 years old, to have another ceremony right here. That will be September of 2014. And at that time, we hope to have marked all of the graves of the War of 1812 veterans. That is, assuming we're successful with the grant applications of the Wonderful World War of 1812 Bicentennial Commission that is pending now. But we invite you back for that. That will be really our contribution when there's so much focus on Fort McHenry and Baltimore for us to honor the defenders at that time. So we hope that you will join us. At this time, I would like to invite up George Rich, the trustee of the Maryland Historical Society, who we saw earlier, presenting that case flag and who traveled here with the manuscript, and with our thanks to the Historical Society for bringing the manuscript here.
I'm just delighted to be here, and thank you, Mr. Fiesler. Before I begin, some things don't change. I had marked this speech up like you wouldn't believe. In any event, on behalf of the Maryland Historic Society and all of your friends here from Baltimore, I bring you greetings from the permanent home of Francis Scott Key's immortal words. We are proud to be able to participate in this special 1812 bicentennial occasion, uniting the original 1814 document with Mr. Key's remains, now permanently honored here at Mount Olivet Cemetery. Not since those proud days after the British were defeated at the Battle of Baltimore in September of 1814 has this manuscript so directly linked with its author been together. There are two accounts, both very credible, of how this song, originally entitled The Defense of Fort McHenry, so quickly became a national phenomenon. Mr. Key, a humble man who did not seek fame and fortune, gave the handwritten four stanzas to his patriotic ballad to either his brother-in-law, Congressman and Militia Commander Joseph Nicholson, or the U.S. Commissioner of Prisoner Exchanges, John Skinner. Within days after the meeting, one of these two men had crafted a printed broadside with a song and lyrics and displayed it on the streets of Baltimore. Newspapers circulated the lyrics throughout America, and within a month, printed sheet music became available of what is now called the Star Spangled Banner. It was first sung professionally in Baltimore in the theater. We talk today about music going viral on the internet, yet even at a time when nothing moved faster than a horse, something as inspiring as this song spread from state to state in a young America. It was moved so by the lyrics of the Star Spangled Banner and the resounding victory in Baltimore Harbor. I hope that everyone here today has had a chance to see our Charter of Freedom at City Hall. If not, I invite you to the Maryland Historic Society in Baltimore, where the Star Spangled document is on permanent display, along with the greatest of the nation's treasures associated with the Battle of Baltimore and Maryland's role in 1812. We are indeed the keeper of Maryland's memory. Our museum and library, dating back to 1844, are perfect for a historical day trip, along with other special 1812 destinations like the Star Spangled Banner Flag House and Fort McHenry. This is the first bicentennial trip for a document so central to the life of Francis Scott Key and the history of our nation. As your tourism director, John Fiesler, has pointed out, Key's life in Maryland is defined by three points of a triangle, measured by his hometown here in Frederick, his memorable achievements in Baltimore Harbor, and his long career as a successful lawyer in Washington, D.C. Next year, during the culmination of Maryland's Star Spangled 200, the manuscript will be joined for the very first time with a flag that inspired it at the Smithsonian's National Museum of American History. These are indeed important events, events that demand reflection and awe at the historic achievements of our ancestors. The ultimate victory at Fort McHenry, articulated by the Star Spangled Banner, established the United States as an independent nation and as a bona fide democracy, where its people are truly citizens, not subjects. In other words, as appear in the closing lyrics of the Star Spangled Banner, the land of the free and the home of the brave. So we extend a very special thank you to all of our friends here in Frederick who have made this event possible. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rich, for joining us and for your remarks this afternoon, and again for the truly terrific honor of us being able to host the manuscript on this occasion. We've heard reference to this gentleman before, the man who really is the reason that all of this happened, Dr. William Beams, who was the person that Francis Scott Key and John Skinner had set out to try to seek his freedom. We'll be treated to an opportunity to hear from Dr. Beams now in the person of Paul Plumman, who's a ranger with Fort McHenry National Monument and Historic Shrine.
Good day. How are you? This very fine day. Yes, my name is Dr. William Beams. It might not mean too much to some of you, but I know definitely that you know of my good friend, Francis Scott Key. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. Well, he and I were caught up in quite an adventure back when our country was young and the Republic was being tested by a war again with the mother country. By 1813, the war had come to our very shores in Maryland. When the British go up and down the Chesapeake Bay, raiding cities, burning, pillaging, plundering like an invading army does. Oh yes, it was a terrible time for the citizens of Maryland. Well, one day, who should I see coming before my very eyes but Mr. Key? With that, startled, I said, "Frank, Frank, what are you doing here now? Are you too a prisoner of the British?" He reassured me, "No, Doctor, I'm here along with Colonel Skinner to work your release." Oh my, I thought, if anybody could do it, it would be Frank Key. You see, the three of us, Mr. Key, Colonel Skinner, and myself, had heard of the British next target city while we were on the decks of their ships, Baltimore. Well, we sailed up the Chesapeake Bay toward Baltimore. They moved us off of the British ship and put us on the little cartel or truce ship that Mr. Key and Colonel Skinner had sailed out of Baltimore on. They put us under British Marine Guard so that we could not sail away and relate to the military figures in Baltimore just how the British had hoped to capture the city. We would be eyewitnesses of the 25-hour attack on Fort McHenry, the main fortress which defended the city of Baltimore. And after the sound of that, some music wafted across the water toward us. Toward the fort. We also saw movement from the British ships. They were preparing to leave. Ah, had we held? I asked Frank, "Can you see the flag?" He pulled out a spyglass. And with that, he joyfully reported to us, "Yes, it's ours. We have indeed, the brave men, the brave defenders had held off."
the British enemy. Throughout the 25 hours, Mr. Key had pulled out a letter from his pocket, and he had been making notes. I would not know exactly what this was all about until released, we were taken to Baltimore at the Indian Queen. There he showed me a draft of his poem, The Defense of Fort McHenry. And as he would say later, he felt that these brave defenders deserved a song. He felt he had to make it. And every time I hear his song sung, it takes me back to those days, those hours, those anxious hours. I carry a little book that has poems in it, and one of them is The Star Spangled Banner. I wonder if you would join with me now in standing to sing the last verse of Mr. Key's poem.
Hold,
please.
Guard, tell us. Attention.
The spirit and we men shall stand between
Summers is the past president, longtime president of the Francis Scott Key Memorial Foundation Board. That foundation, by the way, is the outgrowth of the Frederick County Civil War Centennial Commission. Centennial, 50 years ago, and Tom got involved with it then. After the centennial was over, it turned into the Memorial Foundation. And then we have the folks that worked day in and day out on this project to make it happen so beautifully. from my staff, Chris Hall, who is our Scenic Byway and Special Projects Manager and headed up the whole efforts. And I would do a mention as well that the National Scenic Byway Program helped make these markers happen through some grant funding we were able to receive. David Guiney with Interpretive Direction is been one of the lead partners on this, and Ruth Bielabaki with Ion Design here in Frederick worked to make it look so beautiful. And so without further ado, without further ado, I would ask that you stand one more time, and we will have our officers of the Francis Scott Key Memorial Foundation, Ron Piercy and Colonel George Lewis, Dr. Lewis, will retrieve the flag from the welcome party, from the monument, rather, and return it to Mr. George Rich, trustee of the Maryland Historical Society, where it will travel back to Baltimore with the manuscript and with the eternal thanks of the citizens of Frederick.